JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's weekly market outlook webinar for the week November the 15th until November the 19th. I am Charalambos, Pissouros, head of research here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, following last week's US CPI data, which showed that inflation in the US accelerated by more than anticipated, investors will be eager to find out whether this is the case in other major economies as well. Thus, they may pay extra attention to the UK and Canadian CPI data, where further acceleration could bring forth expectations with regards to rate hikes by the Bank of England and the Bank of Canada. Now, retail sales from both of those nations are also due to be released, but also from the US, with upbeat numbers possibly adding to the view that the Fed could start raising rates as soon as tapering is over. So let's take things from the beginning, though. Today, during the Asian morning, we got Japan's preliminary GDP for the third quarter. The data are already out and showed that economic activity shrank 0.8% quarter over quarter after expanding 0.4% in the second quarter. The forecast was for a 0.2% contraction. So this took the year-over-year rate down to -3% from +1.5%. At its latest gathering, the Bank of Japan kept its monetary policy settings untouched and downgraded its growth and inflation projections, while today Governor Kuroda said that they will maintain their powerful easing strategy and that they stand ready to ramp up stimulus if needed, even as other central banks have begun to or are preparing to start withdrawing pandemic-related policies. Now, in our view, the GDP data add credence to Kuroda's view and leave the yen exposed to another round of selling soon, despite the latest recovery in this currency. With the Bank of Japan keeping a lid on Japanese government bonds and bond yields and other central banks moving towards higher rates, the yield differentials between Japan and other major nations could weigh against the yen at some point in the foreseeable future. Now, China's fixed asset investment, industrial production and retail sales for October are also released today in Asia. Fixed asset investment slowed to 6.1% year over year from 7.3%, while industrial production and retail sales surprisingly accelerated instead of slowing down as their own forecasts suggested. Specifically, they accelerated to 3.5% and 4.9% year over year from 3.1% and 4.4% respectively. The data may be a relief following the latest evidence of a slowing economy, but the deepening debt crisis in the property sector leaves no room for celebration. Now, despite not affecting the overall global market sentiment, this has left marks in the morale of Asian investors, and this is distinct by the fact that Asian equity indices continue to underperform their European and US peers. Now, later today, we get the New York Empire State Manufacturing Index for November, which is expected to have increased to 21.60 from 19.80. This may be a first indication on which direction the official manufacturing index for the whole nation may take and could add credence to the view that the latest bottlenecks have not affected the US economy as much as initially thought. Now, on Tuesday, during the Asian session, the RBA releases the minutes from its latest policy meeting, where it maintained its core policies, rate and quantitative easing untouched, but decided to discontinue the 10 basis points April 2024 yield target, something that was obvious after they failed to defend that level the week before the meeting. They also abandoned the forward guidance that interest rates are most likely to stay unchanged at least until 2024, and suggested that this could happen in 2023. At the press conference following the decision, Governor Lowe said that latest data and forecasts do not warrant an increase in the cash rate in 2022. However, according to the ASX 30-day interbank cash rate futures yield curve, the market still anticipates a 15 basis points hike in June 2022 and sees rates getting very close to 1% in December. Therefore, stronger hints that the RBA is not planning to touch the rate next year could hurt the Aussie again. As we noted after the meeting, with expectations around interest rate hikes staying elevated with regards to hikes by the RBA, there is ample room for more disappointment, and thereby more downside potential for the Australian currency. Imagine that with expectations staying elevated, if we get more hints with regards to not getting any rate hikes next year, and also disappointing data from Australia, which could strengthen the case, this leaves room for further declines in the Australian currency. Now, later in the day, the UK employment report for September is expected to reveal that the unemployment rate has ticked down to 4.4% from 4.5%, and that the employment change has added slightly less jobs in the 3 months to September than in the 3 months to August. Now, average hourly earnings, both including and excluding bonuses, are expected to have slowed decently. But although this could be a relief indication for future inflation, market participants will continue biting their nails in anticipation of the UK CPIs for October due out on Wednesday. We will discuss the UK CPIs in a while. Now, staying on Tuesday, from the Eurozone, we get the second estimate of the GDP for the third quarter, which is expected to confirm its preliminary print of 2.2%. And we also get the bloc's employment change for the quarter, for which no forecast is available, though. Later in the day, all the market attention may turn to the US retail sales for October, as well as the industrial and manufacturing production rates for the same month. Headline sales are forecast to have accelerated to 1.1% month over month from 0.7%, while the core rate is expected to have held steady at 0.8% month over month. Industrial and manufacturing productions are expected to have rebounded 0.7% and 0.8% month over month after sliding 1.3% and 0.7% respectively. Now, in our view, the forecasts point to decent data, which following last week's acceleration in the US CPIs could increase bets over a hike by the Fed as soon as the tapering process is over. Remember that the latest gathering, Fed Chair Powell said that they will stay patient on interest rates, but he did not close the door on the likelihood of an action just after tapering is over. According to the Fed Fund Futures, investors are already pricing in a 25 basis points hike to be delivered in July or August next year, and another round of strong US data could add more credence to their view. This is likely to allow more dollar buying, but in terms of how the equities will react, the answer is not straightforward. Will they slide on speculation that faster rate hikes will hurt profitability of firms, or will they rise on indications that the economy is performing better than previously thought? Now, although the former was the case in the past, we believe that now it is the latter, and thus, even if equities correct somewhat, we expect a rebound very soon. After all, market participants may have already digested the idea of higher rates very soon. Now, on Wednesday, following the acceleration in the US CPIs last week, market participants may be sitting on the edge of their seats in anticipation of more inflation numbers. We do get data for October from the UK, the Eurozone, and Canada. However, Eurozone's numbers will be the final ones, which are just expected to confirm their initial estimates. In the UK, expectations are for the headline CPI rate to jump to 3.9% year over year from 3.1%, while the core one is expected to rise to 3.1% from 2.9%. Now, at its latest meeting, the Bank of England decided not to hike, despite market participants assigning an 80% chance for such a move ahead of the meeting, and instead said that this could happen in coming months. Last Monday, the pound rebounded strongly following remarks by Bank of England Governor Andrew Bailey, who said that they are on a path towards raising interest rates, which may have sparked expectations over a December hike. However, on Thursday, the preliminary UK GDP for the third quarter disappointed, slowing by more than expected. This may have forced market participants to push back their hike expectations, perhaps somewhere in the first months of next year. And this was evident by the retreat of the pound, raising the Bailey-related gains. Anyway, having said all that, a strong acceleration in consumer prices this week will add credence to Governor's Bailey remarks and may revive speculation over a December hike. This is likely to prove positive for the pound. However, the big question here is whether GBP traders are still trusting Bailey, who ahead of the prior meeting has been adding to hopes over a hike, but instead was among those supporting standing pat. So, yes, Bailey is advocating for higher rates very soon. Accelerating inflation could add to the case of a December hike by the Bank of England. But will this be enough? Do pound traders trust Bailey? Because if you remember, Bailey was advocating for high rates again ahead of the November meeting, and was among the officials that was very vocal about it. And was one of the reasons why market participants pushed their bets over a November hike towards an 80% probability. Now, passing the ball to Canada. The headline rate is expected to have continued rising here as well to 4.6 from 4.4%, while no forecast available for the core one. With the Bank of Canada unexpectedly ending its quantitative easing program at its latest gathering, officials may be now looking for the appropriate time to increase interest rates. Around 10 days ago, the employment data revealed a slowdown in jobs growth, but also a slide in the unemployment rate. We don't believe that this may have affected expectations around the hike early next year very much, and further acceleration in inflation could strengthen the case, providing some support to the Canadian dollar. That said, we are reluctant to call for a long-lasting recovery, and this is due to the latest slide in oil prices. Remember that Canada is a major oil producing and exporting nation, and thereby the loonie is correlated to prices of the black liquid. Now, on Thursday, there are no major events or indicators on the agenda. So let's go to Friday, where during the Asian session, Japan releases its national CPIs for October. No forecast is available for the headline rate, while the core one is anticipated to have held steady at 0.1% year over year, well below the Bank of Japan's objective of 2%. In our view, this is likely to add more credence to the Bank of Japan's stance of maintaining its policy extra loose. Later in the day, we get retail sales data from the UK and Canada for the months of October and September, respectively. In the UK, both the headline and core sales are expected to have rebounded after sliding in September, which could add to expectations over a December hike by the Bank of England, if indeed inflation keeps accelerating on Wednesday. Now, in Canada, headline sales are forecast to have fallen, but core sales are anticipated to have risen at the same pace as in August. Now, given that this is September data and that on Wednesday, the day before, we get October CPIs, we get more important data and more recent ones, we don't expect any major market reaction from Canada's retail sales. We believe that the Canadian dollar will stay driven by the outcome of the Canadian CPIs due out on Wednesday. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great week, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next Monday. If you are interested in more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 9 o'clock AM GMT. So goodbye, have a nice day, and a greater week.
JFT, just fair and direct.